Hello, my name is Dr. George Sparks, and this is Bible Interact. I was asked to actually lecture about Abraham, the historical Abraham that's mentioned in Genesis. However, I thought it was rather difficult to actually try to talk about an individual or prove his existence when we have no sarcophagus or body for Abraham. Now we have a traditional location in Hebron that Herod the Great built around 2,000 years ago, and it's called Machpelah. But understand, that's just traditional. I talked this over with Dr. Ann Davis, and we thought this would be very interesting to look at the historical ethnic background of Abraham and try to locate that in the book of Genesis. Now, what do I mean by the ethnic background of Abraham? Well, I'm from Ohio, and since I'm from Ohio, we have certain type of a vocabulary that we use that's unique to us. For instance, if we offer somebody a can of soda, we might say, "Would you like a pop?" And I was in Albuquerque, New Mexico, and I was offering somebody a soda, and I just turned around and said, "Hey, would you like a pop?" And he said to me, "You must be from Ohio." And I go, "What do you mean?" He goes, "Everybody from Ohio just says pop. They don't say soda pop. They don't designate what type. They just say everything's a pop." And I go, "Hey, you know, you're right. I'm from Columbus, Ohio." You know, if we go to southern Ohio or in Kentucky, the English language has a slang to it, you know, a twang. And if we go down to by Louisiana, the English language is drawn out. So we can identify with our own culture and by our own language where we might be located as individuals in different states. Our ethnic background just here in the United States. I wonder if other countries actually would say the alphabet differently than how we say it in the United States. Our own alphabet. Well, what do I mean? What do I mean? Here in the United States, we learn our alphabet basically by singing it. How many Americans can actually say the alphabet without turning around and start to sing it? I think very, very few. So we're looking at certain traditions and customs that might be presented in the biblical narrative that we can find associated with Abraham's ethnic origin, thereby doing the best we can through archaeology and literature, finding the historical Abraham, of which the Bible tells us he is actually from Ur of the Chaldees. So in Genesis chapter 15 and 7, I'm going to read, "He," which is God, "and he said to Abram, I am the Lord who brought you out of Ur of the Chaldees to give you the land to promise. Now, by saying this, we understand that Ur of the Chaldees is actually a term that might be used in an anachronism of later resource. Okay, so it's like a scribal insert. The Ur of the Chaldees is actually from more of an Iron Age period to say Chaldees. But the location is still the same. Abraham is from Ur, which would be Mesopotamia. Here we have a map, if you will, of the migration of Abraham. It starts from Mesopotamia. And when we say Mesopotamia, we have the word meso, which means middle. So when you say meso or middle Mesopotamia, it means the land between the two rivers, Tigris and Euphrates. And this is where we find Ur of the Chaldees. And we start with Babylon. We move towards the land of the Assyrians, the Mitannis, the Hittites, and then we start to migrate south into the land of Canaan. And then we wind up in Egypt, because Abraham spends a short amount of time in Egypt. Now, also we look for Abraham in archaeology through artifacts. And archaeologists like to go to certain locations to find their artifacts. And the easiest ones would be locations which we call tells. A T-E-L means strength. What is strength? The strength of location is designated by certain things. First of all, is there a road next to it, somewhere to trade, a road, a water source, you have to have a water source, and third, it has to be elevated to be in a defensive location. And this is the strength to be in a defensive location. So places like Gezer and Megiddo and Hazor are all very strong defended locations along the trade route that we read about in the Bible. So in this map, when we look at tell sites, the earliest civilization is towards the bottom, which we might call Chalcolithic, copper and stone. Then we go to the Bronze Age, early Bronze Age, and then we go to the Middle Bronze Age period. Now, the Middle Bronze Age period is possibly the time period of Abraham, okay? So as you look at the map, as we go to the towards the top of the tell, we have these different archaeological periods. Now, associated with the archaeological periods, as we go to the top of the tell or towards the bottom of the tell, we have artifacts. And the artifacts that you're seeing on this next chart designate types of artifacts that are found throughout the Herodian period or the Roman period, also the time of the Exodus, and as far back as what we might call the early Bronze and Middle Bronze Age. These artifacts are being represented in this next slide. Okay, now we have an actual pottery chart that dates all the way down. If you look to the bottom of it, it says Chalcolithic period, around 4000 BC. It goes all the way up to the Byzantine period, which dates to around 640 CE of the Common Era. Now, we have to go back to the bottom of that chart, and this one is actually expanded for you to see, and you'll see Middle Bronze Age 2, and here we have a selection of pottery. Now, because of the biblical narrative, we have literature that would date it, if we take it very literally, possibly to 2100 BC, but scholars date Abraham anywhere between 2100 to 1800 BC, which still puts us in the intermediate to Middle Bronze Age, and there's pottery that is very distinctive to those periods. The most common pottery of that time period, or any period, are the ancient lamps. Now, you look at a building that you might be in, or the house that you're in, all the light switches that you see. Now, imagine all those light switches to be lamps of the ancient world. You might have 50 different switches in your house. So think of maybe even half of that, 25 lamps per house in the ancient world, and you can see how important it would be for archaeologists just to understand the different types of lamps that we could find at a tell location, which designates also a time period. For instance, this first lamp that we have could be dated to the intermediate time period, the time of Abraham, around 2100 BC. We call that the four-cornered lamp. It's just a bowl that's been pinched on four sides, and those four pinched locations are where the ancient people would put an old piece of cloth or a wick, and that would be, you could say, absorbed by olive oil, and they would light it. The next lamp is from the late Bronze Age, between 1550 and 1200 BC, and you can see now it looks more like a shell, like a bowl that's only been pinched on one side. And now we have a selection of lamps from the Roman period to the Byzantine period. They're a little bit different because the lamps that I showed you prior were all made on a potter's wheel. Now, the potter's wheel actually starts around 2000 BC. So when we see pottery that is hand-formed, we know that the hand-formed pottery is more likely older than 2000 BC. And when we start to see wheel-made pottery, we could say 2000 BC and later. And when we start to look at lamps, when lamps are actually pressed into molds, giving it different shapes and appearances, this would date to the Hellenistic period, Roman period, Byzantine period. So we can date these lamps that you see on this slide right here pretty much to the late Roman, Byzantine period. Now, the next thing we're going to look at is a type of writing style. And this particular style is called cuneiform. Cuneiform means wedged form, because they would not write with ink and pen on paper, but what they would actually do is use a little stylus and they press it into clay. And this is called cuneiform. It's a system of writing first in Mesopotamia that begins around 3500 to 3000 BC. It's very significant because cuneiform would be the type of writing style that Abraham would have used in his commerce. Now we have two particular styles of cuneiform tablets in this next slide. The first one is a teaching round circular cuneiform tablet, and the cuneiform is very large and is fitting within lines. Now you think of these lines as paper that would be used by a first or second grader, and they're learning how to write, but they have to stay in the lines, okay? So this instructor, this teacher, is actually teaching these students some 2,000 plus years ago how to write on cuneiform tablets. Now, the reverse one is a student's tablet, and now you can see that the lines are crooked, and the cuneiform actually doesn't fit in there as solid as the teacher's instructions on the first side, okay? So the first side is the teacher, and you reverse it, and the second, or the reverse side of the cuneiform tablet would be the students. And these are called teaching tablets. So that means that 2,000, 3,000 years ago, kids, you still had homework. Now we got to the cuneiform, we're actually going to look at some of the, you could say, historical, ethnic background material that would be similar to that we read about, or which we read about, in the biblical narrative in Genesis, okay? Now, why is that important? Because we're looking for the origins of the historical Abraham. First, we have the Enuma Elish. These are, this one right here happens to be a Babylonian creation tablets, which when you say Enuma Elish, it actually means wind from above. It's the creation of, you could say, our world as they saw this in the ancient Mesopotamian culture. Okay, so what is the Enuma Elish? It's about 1,000 lines of cuneiform text on 7 large tablets. It can date anywhere between 600 BC, as far back as 1700 BC, but even further, around 2100, or what we would call the intermediate period, or the time period, which would be the literal time of Abraham in the biblical text. It's a poetic form referring to the creation. It gives credit to the Mesopotamian gods, such as Marduk. Fragments are found throughout the Middle East, even a location which I'll talk about later on, which you'll find very interesting and significant. The Enuma Elish, how is it similar to Genesis? Okay, we have a divine creation of the cosmos and the matter. Also, we have a desolate waste area and darkness being covered by the deep. We have light that is created by God in the firmaments and above the earth. And we have the luminaries later, such as the sun and the moon and the stars. And towards the end of this creation theory, the Enuma Elish, we have man being created. And then finally, God, or in the Mesopotamian culture, plural, their gods rested. So some scholars actually would think that the Enuma Elish is mentioning what we would call the first Sabbath. Okay? But that's just some scholars suggest. In Genesis chapter 1 and verse 16, I'll read, "And God made two great lights, the greater light to rule the day, the lesser light to rule the night, and the stars. And there was evening and there was morning, which he called the fourth day." Now we also have what is called the Adam and Eve cylinder seal. This dates to around 2200 and 2100 B.C., and this is, once again, the intermediate period, dates to the time period of Abraham. And here we have a male and female sitting around a large tree. And from the tree, we have serpents that are protruding from the tree. Some scholars once said that this is depicting the story of the book of Genesis. Now it's highly debated. In Genesis chapter 2 and verse 8, it says, "And the Lord God planted a garden in Eden in the east, and there he put the man whom he had formed. The tree of life was in the midst of the garden, and the tree of the knowledge of good and evil." So here we have, you could say, a evidence of the historical backgrounds of Abraham through the biblical text, as it's related also in the Mesopotamian culture, in the Enuma Elish. Now we have what was called the Mesopotamian King's List. It's a large cylinder seal. Also, it's called the Sumerian King List. And in this slide, I'll just read quickly. It's a list of an ancient manuscript originally recorded in the Sumerian language listing the kings of Sumer. Now, why is this important? Because in this listing of kings, the kings of Sumer, according to the Mesopotamian King's List, lived for thousands of years, 10,000 years, 20,000 years. And also in the biblical narrative, we read how certain individuals lived for a long time, such as Methuselah. In Genesis chapter 5 and verse 25, it reads, "When Methuselah lived 187 years, he fathered Lamech. Methuselah lived after he fathered Lamech 782 years and had other sons and daughters." Genesis 5 and 27, "Thus all the days of Methuselah were 969 years and he died." That's a long time to live. All right. Now, did people actually live that long? Now, if we take that text very literal, we'd have to say yes. Some scholars suggest, after looking at this Mesopotamian kings list, that they had a different type of counting system. Others suggested, and I like this particular one, that what they were actually doing is that they were suggesting, because the kings were placed in power by their gods, or if we want to talk about Methuselah and then later Noah, that they were placed in their positions by God, singular, that since they were in that position of authority, what they did in their lifetime would be equivalent to what an average person could possibly do in 969 years, in 10,000 years, in 20,000 years. So it's a symbolic number, seemingly depicting the greatness of that king and what he did. And in the Bible, it does appear in some instance that people that lived a long time, it's depicting their closeness to the creation of Adam or their closeness to God. The next one I'm going to talk about is the Epic of Gilgamesh. And the Epic of Gilgamesh is an ancient Mesopotamian text or poem about the flood. The flood story, as it is read in the Epic of Gilgamesh, was first discovered in 1872 by George Smith, the British Museum. Now, it was a surprising announcement that he made after excavating the library of Assyrian king Ashurbanipal, which dates to the 7th century BC. Here, in translating these texts, he found out that there was a Mesopotamian tradition, an epic, that was very similar in structure, I'm just going to say similar, not exact, to the epic event of the flood mentioned in Genesis of the Bible. Okay? Now, this epic poem dates to the 3rd dynasty of Ur, once again, 2100 BC. I think that's significant because we keep on reading around 2200 to 2100 BC, which in the Bible is the literal date of the arrival, or the, you say, the beginnings of the Abraham tradition, okay? In the Epic of Gilgamesh, it starts very simply, and you can read this slide for yourself later on, slower. We have the flood myth section. Also, we have the leak, the secret plan of the deities, as God would tell later Noah that the flood was coming and he needs to build an ark. So there's the building and the launching of a boat as well, and then the storm, and then the calm after the storm, and then later, as in the book of Genesis, a sacrifice. Now, what's interesting about the book of Gilgamesh, it's a sacrifice, but it's done on a mountainous, what they call a mountainous ziggurat. Now, here's the location where the Epic of Gilgamesh was found in the land of Canaan. Along the trade route, it was found at Tel Megiddo. So here we have actual evidence, hard archaeological evidence, that the Mesopotamian Epic of Gilgamesh, the story of the flood, was known in the land of Canaan. And here's a cylinder seal also depicting an individual in a box, being protected, being surrounded by water. Some scholars depict this, and it's called the flood cylinder seal or the Noah seal. This is an ancient ziggurat. These are found in Mesopotamia. This one actually has been reconstructed. And in the Epic of Gilgamesh, it does mention the mountainous structure, which is identified as a ziggurat. Now, where do we read about this in the Bible? Okay, the Tower of Babel. The tower. Now, the word tower is Hebrew for Migdal. And the Migdal is just a high structure. In Genesis chapter 11 and verse 4, it says, "Then they said, come, let us build ourselves a city and a tower with its top in the heavens, and let us make a name for ourselves, lest we be dispersed over the face of the whole earth." Now, once again, the word tower means Migdal, all right? But also the word top comes from the Hebrew word rush, like Rosh Hashanah, the beginning of the year. Also, rush means head, like the beginning, the top. So when we could read the top that reaches unto heaven, it could be the top of the structure if we read it literally, but we know if it goes so high, you're going to run out of oxygen. So what some scholars suggest is the tower that was supposed to be used as a pulpit and the rush, which means the head, or the high priest, during their services would actually reach unto heaven, or in other words, have their services at the top. Very similar to the way the Aztecs would do in, you could say, Central America with their structures. Also, we have treaties and covenants. In Genesis chapter 5 and verse 15 and 9, we have a covenant between God and Abraham. It says, he said to him, God says to Abraham, bring me a heifer 3 years old, a female goat 3 years old, a ram 3 years old, turtle dove, and young pigeon. And he brought him all these, cut them in half, and laid each half over against the other. But he did not cut the birds in half. And this is very interesting because I have seen cuneiform tablets, or terracotta tablets, in the form of little altars. And on these altars, it has animals divided in half, but the birds are intact and whole, laid next to each other. And in Kenneth Kitchen's book, Reliability of the Old Testament, he actually would date this particular covenant to around the Middle Bronze Age, we could say around in the middle 18th century BC, this type of covenant. Then the Lord made a covenant in 1517. When the sun had gone down and it was dark, behold, a smoking fire pot and a flaming torch passed between the pieces. And on that day, the Lord made a covenant between Abraham, saying, to your offspring I will give this land, the river of Egypt, to the great river, the river Euphrates. Now, what's interesting about this particular lesson is that we have a number of different items that we read about in the Old Testament that do stem from Mesopotamian traditions. Now, this is where the Bible says that Abraham was from. So it would make sense that if Abraham is relaying to, you say, in tribal traditions about the origins of where he was from through his, you could say, literary, verbal transactions within his people, it would stem from early Mesopotamian traditions. So we have, in the beginning, we have the Enuma Elish, the wind from above, the creation text. And then after that, we have the Sumerian king's list, where it talks about the long reigns of the kings of that time, such as in Genesis, the ages of the patriarchs that lived before the flood. And then we also have the archaeological evidence of, you could say, writing styles, the cuneiform language, which Abraham used. And also we looked at a brief teaching text. And then secondly, or thirdly, we have the Epic of Gilgamesh, which is the flood. And lastly, we had the mentioning of a ziggurat in the Epic of Gilgamesh, which in Genesis we have the evidence of building a tower in the beginnings of the Tower of Babel. So here we have lots of literature very early in the book of Genesis that we have similarities to in the Mesopotamian tradition prior to and during the time of Abraham. Now, it's interesting to note that in any culture, we seem to hang on to what's dear to us. Whether it be, you could say, our heritage by the way that we dress or the way that we might talk, but also our religious beliefs as well. And we hold that very dear. And it seems that during times of, you could say, strife, or times that we would have of the times where we would have great things that would happen for ourselves or our country, that we would include with that the early origins of our heritage in the United States. Now, we could say that our early heritage was Christian to many of us. So I think this is very interesting because on December 24th, 1968, this was a time where we were coming out of the, you could say, the crisis of the revolts of, you could say, the racist parties during the mid-1960s. And then we also had the era of Vietnam. Our country was in great strife. But it seems not just our country, but the whole world was backing one major event that we were doing as a nation. And that was we were trying to walk on the moon. So on December 24th, 1968, the Apollo 8 actually circled around the moon, orbited around the moon for the first time. And on appearing or seeing the Earth, the astronauts, Bill Anders, Jim Lovell, and Frank Borman, actually quoted from Genesis in the King James Version, Genesis chapter 1 through Genesis verse 1 to verse 10. So I'd like to end this. My name is Dr. George Sparks, and this is Bible Interact, but I would like to finish with the presentation of the astronauts actually quoting from Apollo 8, Genesis chapter 1. Thank you.
We are now approaching lunar sunrise, and for all the people back on Earth, the crew of Apollo 8 has a message that we would like to send to you. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. And the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters. And God said, "Let there be light." And there was light. And God saw the light, that it was good. And God divided the light from the darkness. And God called the light day. And the darkness he called night, and the evening and the morning was the first day. And God said, "Let there be a firmament in the midst of the waters. Let it divide the waters from the waters." And God made the firmament, and divided the waters which were under the firmament from the waters which were above the firmament. And it was so. And God called the firmament heaven, and the evening and the morning was the second day. God said, "Let the waters under the heaven be gathered together into one place, and let the dry land appear," and it was so. And God called the dry land earth, and the gathering together of the waters called he seas. God saw that it was good.
Bible Interact, uncovering the mysteries of the kingdom of God. At BibleInteract.tv, you will penetrate the scriptures of the Bible. At our store, you're just one click away from owning your favorite books, DVDs, or study guides. Earn a degree from our university and watch hundreds of video presentations from biblical scholars, archaeologists, and theologians. By subscribing to Bible Interact, you'll find all the resources you'll need. So why not subscribe today? Go to www.BibleInteract.tv. You'll be glad you did. Interested in studying more about the temple, the Messiah, or what God's plan is for our future? No problem. We've got you covered. With more than 200 DVDs, books, and workbooks, you'll find the answers you've been searching for. Bible Interact, uncovering the mysteries of the kingdom of God.